Anh chơi nhận cái chỗ. Ông nông nhập đẹp và cả bản tổ bờ xã Mà Nà Cà. กาปีประมันกาปีรัสเซียมาเซลมันบนปีละมันจบองค์จำเริบบานจำเริบมาจูนได้ให้ตามกาปีพิในกิจกรรมนาคาสัมนาคาได้กาปีมาเซลมันยังฝึกเป็นตอนจบเนื้อไหลคือเหล่านี้ดอลยุติสัพพิญญาลงกาฝึกกาฉลอยตอบ จนนังกาจมตัวระบบเบตาวีตังใบกรมตุชนัยองจมเรียสมบุกุลปิติกาตือเพื่อกีสหปริญญาโดยสหปริญญาเมียนยะปิลมวยมองจะไปเพื่อการฉลอยตอบยมปูการจมตัวระบบเบตาวีตังใบกรมสมเชิญ
Good morning, Your Honours. Good morning,
William
Smith.
Good morning, General Public.
Your Honours, as we mentioned yesterday, today I will be addressing generally the prosecution's general objections to the defence objections to the admissibility of the documents. And then my learned colleague, Mr. Darius Mochan, we'll look at a few of the document types and provide some examples of how that indicia of reliability can be found within the documents. Briefly, Your Honour, I think yesterday the defence and the prosecution to a certain extent were in general agreement with the legal test for admissibility that documents should be prima facie relevant, on its face relevant, and prima facie reliable, on its face reliable. But I think the differences arose in how that test would be applied, and the difference may have arisen with the manner in which that test be applied. But firstly, if I can make, I'll make 4 points in terms of our general response to four general objections that have been raised in the documents. But prior to making those 4 points, I'd like to mention a couple of preliminary matters as to how each of the accused or their counsel are approaching the issue of its admissibility. And our view would be is that that approach that's being put forward by each of the defendants is not completely in accordance with the practice and the law as agreed. Firstly, in relation to Khieu Samphan's counsel raised the obligation with Your Honours that the prosecution have the responsibility to prove the prosecution case beyond reasonable doubt. And that's absolutely clear. The prosecution doesn't shy away from that. These are incredibly serious proceedings, and the burden of proof is very high for the prosecution. However, what the counsel for the Khieu Samphan team did was try and equate the burden of proof at the end of the case with the burden of proof to have documents admitted. And it's submitted on the law that we presented yesterday, and the law that was placed in our pleadings, that clearly that's not the case. At the admissibility stage, all that need be shown is prima facie relevant,
and prima facie reliable. There's a reason for that, of course, that if each piece of evidence had to be proved beyond all reasonable doubt, we would have trials within trials within trials, and the process will never end. The safeguard for the accused is that the material facts in the indictment must be proved beyond reasonable doubt. And Your Honours, we submit, can only arrive at that if Your Honours looks at the full compass, the full scope of the evidence to determine if all of those pieces add up on any particular primary allegation to find that fact proved beyond reasonable doubt. If Your Honours have a higher standard for the admissibility of evidence, the problem that will be faced is that Your Honours will never get to look at any evidence because a far too onerous inquiry would occur for each piece of evidence. So the safeguard is still there, but the test is much lower for those obvious reasons. If we move to Nguyen Chia, again, there was general agreement on the test. However, Your Honours were asked to steer away from international practice in terms of international tribunals dealing with cases of this type with their approach on admissibility. Counsel for Nguyen Chia stated that the approach of the international tribunals is perhaps a more liberal approach than in national courts, whether it be Cambodia or any other court. And the reason for that, of course, is that these cases are so big that if Your Honours apply a strict approach to the admissibility of evidence, you would not see the full breadth of the evidence that Your Honours have to take in to determine whether or not mass crimes against humanity across Cambodia in fact occurred. You can't call in every witness. You can't have an original for every document. You can't prove the chain of custody for every piece of evidence. There must be other ways in which you can, Your Honours can fully comprehend the evidence so that your judgment is based on a rich set of facts rather than isolated pieces that perhaps would not connect and would take away from the integrity of the judgment. So, although the Nguyen Chia agreed generally with the legal test for admissibility, they've asked Your Honours to steer away from the international practice, and we suggest you should not do that because it's the international tribunals that are working with cases of these size, and such liberal approach is important if Your Honours wants to see all the evidence. That said, we agree with the Nguyen Chia team that it's important that this court applies fundamental principles which apply to the Cambodian courts because that's required under the law. But also, this court needs to set an example. And by applying fair process or fair trial rights, protecting the interests of the accused, making sure civil parties' interests are protected, and also making sure that Your Honours get to see all of the evidence, you can adopt those principles that are the same as the national courts, and so it can be very instructive for the national courts as to how trials should progress. But when it comes to the technicalities of admissibility of evidence and some of those international standards that are adopted, we submit Your Honours should adopt them because the national courts are not dealing with cases of this size. Finally, in relation to the Yang Sari defense, again, there's general agreement on tests of admissibility. However, I think the test that was specifically put forward was a little academic and not quite practical or workable in a court, this court, or any court. And as Your Honours remember, the Yang Sari team put forward, or the council put forward, that the admissibility test should be in three stages. One, that Your Honours should first look at authenticity of the document, and then if it's authentic, you should move to the next stage, is it reliable, and then, and only then, you should look at whether or not the evidence is relevant. Apart from the fact that we agree with the Yang Sari Council that those elements are a part of the test, but as we have said yesterday, the international jurisprudence shows that authenticity is in fact an element of reliability, so it's incorporated with that analysis. And the idea that you only look at authenticity and reliability first and then relevant, what that can lead to is a prolonged process where if the evidence is clearly irrelevant at the outset, much time has been wasted to get to that point. So Your Honours have adopted a different approach. Your Honours have adopted, you've asked the prosecution and the other parties to put in their documents, document lists in April last year, and you've asked the parties to establish the relevance which has been done. And so we would say that the approach is that the relevance and reliability is largely done at the same time, and that's how this process can be workable. Moving now, Your Honours, to the four general objections, or the four general responses we have to the defence objections to the documents, I think either singularly or combined, the defence raised 4 points as to why these documents, the majority of the documents that are supporting the closing order, should not be admitted. Firstly, it's been put forward by the defence that the accused has an absolute right to summon any author of any document at all pursuant to Rule 84.1. And as Your Honours are aware, Rule 84.1 gives the defence the right to summon any witness that they haven't had an opportunity to question during the investigation phase. We would submit, Your Honours, the interpretation of that rule is such that that relates to witnesses that have provided statements or written records to the co-investigative judges. It doesn't apply to other types of documents like media statements, or books, or academic articles, or academic reports. Because at the international courts, when they apply the evidentiary rules to cases of this size, rather than asking for the authors to come, they allow hearsay evidence. They allow out-of-court statements made by others to be taken into account by Your Honours because of the sizes of the case. They allow media reports produced at the time of the events, contemporaneous with the events, to be used as corroborative evidence to the other evidence in the case. They allow books, they allow academic articles, and they allow analytical reports. And the reason why they allow them is because those reports and books provide Your Honours with guidance and very informed advice as to the context, the historical background, the general policies of the background to the indictment. The effort that is required to put all that evidence into a cohesive form is massive. It's people's lives work. And as a result of that, the courts have allowed these types of documents to come in as an exception to the right to question every witness because they are valuable. They allow Your Honours to see how the context in which the evidence that you are particularly hearing, whether it be oral testimony or other documentary evidence, can be put into place.
That said, normally documents of that type are used as corroboration rather than the primary evidence, rather than the oral testimony or other very significant contemporaneous documents.
And
we've provided those cases in the pleadings that support that, and we would ask Your Honours to follow that international practice. Otherwise, what will happen is you will rob yourself of the opportunity to see how the matrix of evidence fits together.
But
the way the international courts have looked at that type of evidence, it is a question of weight rather than admissibility. So, for example, if an accused makes 50 statements during the Democratic Party period, and all those statements are of a similar type, or of a similar policy, if they all come from different media sources or different outlets, they're all saying the same thing, at the end, Your Honours can place great weight on that, subject to any substantive channel challenge by the defence. So we would ask Your Honours to follow the international jurisprudence on these other types of documents, allow them in so that Your Honours can have that context, and allow them in so that Your Honours can see all of the evidence that's available, rather than just the memory of a witness 40 years later that comes into the courtroom. Secondly, Your Honours, the defence generally have objected to documents going in unless the original transcripts or tape recordings of a witness or an accused statement contained in any document is placed before the court or whether they have access to it. We would submit that there isn't an express right for that to demand media reports that were produced, say for example, back in 75 to 79, to demand that original transcripts of those reports or original notes of those reports, those many, many reports, to be brought forward, we would say it's far too onerous and far too costly for the court. Your Honours can look at the reliability of that evidence by looking at how it fits with the context of other evidence. Is it consistent? Is it internally consistent? And does it externally, is it externally corroborated by events? Your Honours, we went through all the different criteria that we propose that can be used to determine that minimum level of reliability. But we would say that demanding notes and tape recordings and transcripts of interviews done years earlier is a far too costly exercise, but without much benefit in terms of being able to determine its reliability. But as Your Honours know, under Rule 25, in relation to the written records, the defence have a right to look at the tape recordings of all the witnesses, the written statements of the witnesses in the case file. And if there's an anomaly, they can bring that up to Your Honours. Ideally, as the prosecution has said, it would be useful if all of those tape recordings were transcribed and if all of those tape recordings were available. But it's a lengthy exercise, and we are saying that Your Honours should not not allow the admission of those written records just because that transcript of that statement hasn't been provided. Because remember, the witness has at the bottom of that statement signed and said, this is a true and accurate account of what I've told the investigators. So any small nuance between a question and answer method and the summary of the evidence is counterbalanced by the fact that the witness has had an opportunity to read the statement and say, sign it as a true accounting of events. Your Honours, if I go back one step, we do
There is, we do agree with the defense that there is a right for the defense to request the presence of witnesses that have given written records to the OCIJ as to the acts and conduct of the accused. And the reason why we agree with that is because we believe that's the state of the law at the international tribunals. As Your Honour is aware, at these tribunals, evidence is allowed to be presented to the trial chamber in statement form without calling the witness if, as long as they don't relate to the acts and conduct of the accused. And if so, before Your Honour places any reliance on that evidence, that witness should be available to be called. So that's the position the prosecution have in relation to written records. So we would submit that Your Honour accepts the written records in the historical background section of the indictment where they to show the historical background, policies, structure, etc., but don't accept it on the basis that where it shows provides evidence of the acts and conduct of the accused, that Your Honours put that evidence aside and not take that into account. But for every other reason, we submit those statements should be accepted. Thirdly, Your Honours, there seems to be a general objection that unless a significant chain of custody for all of these documents can be proved, that the documents should in fact not be admitted. As explained yesterday, Your Honours, the international jurisprudence on admissibility in terms of reliability, it doesn't require any one criteria of reliability to be a prerequisite for the admission of any particular document. It doesn't require that it be shown to the court that the chain of custody from the discovery of the document to the admission into the courtroom be proved every step of the way over the last 30 years, 35 years. It doesn't require that. It doesn't require that because largely can often be too difficult and too time-consuming, and in fact the proceedings will take far too long. When what the ultimate goal is in terms of admissibility is determine whether it's got that minimum level of reliability. So the argument is, why do you take the long road when there's a shorter road to take in terms of looking at the internal characteristics and the external characteristics of the document? If we take the long road to every piece of evidence and finding the reliability for every piece of evidence to that nth degree, this trial, of course, won't end. And it's not necessary, it's not required under the law. In terms of the prosecution, there was some criticism that the prosecution somehow wasn't concerned with chain of custody or perhaps there was not much evidence on file about the chain of custody of these documents. I think it's quite clear that there are many witnesses on the case file, for example, telegram witnesses that can testify to telegrams showing the authenticity of those documents. There's a witness from the printing house that produced the revolutionary flag and the red flags. That witness is on the case file. We've asked for that witness to come to court. We have statements from Yuk Chang, the director of the Documentation Center of Cambodia, as to the authenticity or at least the custody of those documents. I mean, the director's opinion on any particular test for authenticity is one thing, but really it's up to Your Honours to decide how you would determine the reliability of the document. Your Honours, the prosecution has put forward in the witness list, and Your Honours have decided to call someone from the Documentation Center of Cambodia. And that witness that Your Honour has decided to call is quite able to testify to the custody of That witness has been at DC Cam for 15 years. That witness has been at the organization for about the same length of time as Chan. So we would submit, as much as Chain of Custody, Your Honours require some further proof of some custody of documents, the witness you have selected, which we have put forward, is quite able and quite appropriate to be able to provide that extra information. The prosecution hasn't shied away from the fact that Yuk Chang does have valuable information, but so does the other witness that Your Honour has selected. And we would suggest that before any decision about calling anyone else in relation to Chain of custody of documents from the DC Cam, that Your Honour hear the testimony as you've decided to. Again, chain of custody not being an essential requirement to prove reliability, but ultimately Your Honours have to be satisfied, and so we welcome that evidence. Just one general comment about the defence's views that, regardless of whether or not chain of custody can be provided to the court in relation to a number of the documents, any document that was housed by DC Cam or stored by DC Cam under their custody should not be admitted into this courtroom is just illogical. It doesn't make any sense. Because what the defence is saying is that because the Documentation Centre of Cambodia, one of its goals or mandates is to look at and search for the truth during the democratic Kampuchea period, because they have said that genocide, that's a layperson's term, often used in that way, even though it's a specific legal meaning. But because crimes against humanity have occurred in Cambodia, or there's a recognition of that, somehow or not, somehow or another, they are biased. To be fair, to be honest, that is a ludicrous point to make. Of course, they are not acting for any particular defence or any particular victim, but they're searching for the truth. And so, whatever the mandate of the organisation, that doesn't relate any bias or any sort of goal of that organisation. That can't be imported to the documents that they house. The question of admissibility relates to the documents, but not to the organisation itself. By saying that any organisation, for example, a police force that investigates crimes, is necessarily biased, and because of that fact, any of the evidence they collect should not be placed before the court, just doesn't make sense. I mean, everyone has an ethical obligation, of course, to ensure that whatever investigations are carried out appropriately. That would be like the prosecution saying that any document put forward by the defence team, by the Nguyen Chia or Yang Seri defence team, is biased because they have interest in protecting, they have a responsibility to protect their client's interests. Of course that's not the case, and of course we wouldn't object on that basis. The bias or the lack of reliability has to relate to the document, but not to the organisation. Finally, Your Honours, in relation to a general objection by Khieu Samphan, it appears that counsel for Khieu Samphan are complaining somehow or another that they're not getting an opportunity to examine the documents and demanding that at some stage or another we need to have the opportunity to examine the documents. Your Honours are doing this now. We're doing this right now, and we've been doing it for the last 4 years. Defence counsel for Khieu Samphan and others have had access to this case file for 4 years. Their responsibility, our responsibility, has been to examine those documents over that period. Then, Your Honours, we have provided, in response to your order, a list of the documents that we are going to rely on or put forward to the chamber. And as your honours are aware, we provided a list of about 4,500 documents, about 6,500. But about 4,500 relating to the first phase. And we've described every document, we've dated it, we've referenced it, we've said how it's relevant. We provided that on the 19th of April in 2011. The defence is aware of the rules, but at some point in the trial, they actually have to have an opinion on the documents. The rules say that. They give your honours the right to ask the parties to object to documents prior to the trial and shortly after the trial begins. Then, Your Honours, Your Honours have invited the parties to object to the documents in writing. Everyone has taken that opportunity. And then, Your Honours, have provided for these hearings where people can put their comments forward. Your Honours have seen the prosecution's Rule 92 statement. Basically, it's a 40 or 50-page statement outlining the indicia of reliability for all different document types. We can go on forever and ever providing this indicia of reliability, but at some point, Your Honours, we would submit that the prosecution has undertaken its burden, that minimum burden which just identifying to Your Honours prima facie, on its face, the documents are reliable. We have done that through the pleadings. Your Honours have provided us an opportunity this week to discuss annexes 1 to 5. As Your Honours are aware, we have another 15 annexes which we would like to put before the court, and we welcome the opportunity and we recognise Your Honours' scheduling of other documentary hearings. But, Your Honours, we would submit, if it's a complaint from the Khieu Samphan team that they're not getting an opportunity to examine the documents, we would submit it's wholly unfounded. The opportunity is now, and the opportunity is this week, and the opportunity is through those pleadings. If the parties don't take that opportunity, that's really a question for them. But you've allowed the opportunity for examination of the documents. We would submit that does not mean that the parties sit day in and day out reading document after document after document. I mean, we will be here for years. The opportunity has been provided, and we would ask Your Honours to accept that fact and then make your findings on those documents. And then, to conclude, at the end, Your Honours, we would say that it's really a question of weight for these documents. Once you've found that they're prima facie admissible, once your first impression is that the document is what it intends to be, then Your Honour should admit those documents so that we can look at and understand the evidence that is already in this trial and determine what is necessary in terms of further witnesses. We submit that Your Honours have a duty, of course, to ascertain the truth of the indictment and also a duty to protect and the accused rights. We ask that the duty to ascertain the truth requires you to look at the evidence broadly and requires you to look at the admissibility rules of the international jurisprudence so that you can get a full impression of the evidence and then at the end of the case determine the weight should be placed on each piece of evidence. Your Honours, I would now turn to my colleague, Darasmay Chan, and he will just provide, in relation to a few groups of documents, some of the indicators that we've recognised already in our written pleadings as to the authenticity of those documents. And as Your Honour is aware, many of the documents in the background section of the closing order are also included in annexes 1 to 5. And so some of those responses in relation to perhaps the interview of Nguyen Nguyen will be put forward by a colleague in the next hearing. But if I now can turn to my colleague. Thank you.
សូមគោរពលោកប្រធានសូមគោរពក្រុមប្រឹក្សាជំនុំជម្រះសូមគោរពអង្គសន្និការទាំងមូល
ខ្ញុំឈ្មោះចន្ទរាស្មីជាសាភិញ្ញារងជាតិនៅស្លាកដីខ្មែរក្រហមនេះជាបន្តទៅនេះខ្ញុំសូមអនុញ្ញាតធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងអ្វីដែលមេធាវីការពារក្តីបានលើកឡើងតាក់ទិនទៅនឹងឯកសារជាភស្តុតាងមួយចំនួនដូចតទៅនេះចំណុចទី1គឺតាក់ទិននឹងឯកសារដែលមានលក្ខណៈជាវីដេអូទី2គឺការបំពេញផ្សាយរបស់បកគុំនេះកម្ពុជានៅក្នុងអបសម្ព័ន្ធទី2ទី3គឺកំណត់ហេតុនៃការប្រជុំរបស់បកគុំនេះកម្ពុជាក្នុងអបសម្ព័ន្ធ3ទី4គឺ statement របស់រដ្ឋាភិបាលកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យដែលនៅក្នុងនោះមានរាប់បញ្ចូលនៅរណសេរីបរិបរមជាតិកម្ពុជានិងរដ្ឋាភិបាលបរិបរមជាតិកម្ពុជាដែលមានការបោះពុំផ្សាយហើយមានយោងនៅក្នុងអបសម្ព័ន្ធទី5ចំណុចទី5គឺតាក់ទិនទៅនឹងរបាយការណ៍សារព័ត៌មានដែលតាក់ទិនទៅនឹងកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យមានឯកសារយោងក្នុងអបសម្ព័ន្ធទី5ចំពោះឯកសារជាភស្តុតាងដែលមានលក្ខណៈជាវីដេអូខ្ញុំនឹងលើកឡើងអំពីការជំទាស់របស់អៀងសេរីទៅនឹងវីដេអូចំនួន2ដែលមានឯកសារយោងគឺ E3/81ឬ D108/32.2 និង E3/124A ឬ D299.1.46A វីដេអូទី1មានឈ្មោះថាស្រមោលពុតពតត្រូវបានចំទាស់ទៅនឹងមូលដ្ឋានថាវាជាឧបសម្ព័ន្ធមួយនៃសំណើរបស់ការចល័យសហប្រញ្ញាដែលបានស្វែងរកការបញ្ចូលសម្ភារៈប្រភេទនេះទៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿង001មេធាវីការពារក្តីបានលើកឡើងថាដោយសារសំណើវីដេអូនេះមិនតាក់ទិននឹងសំណុំរឿងនេះដូចនេះវីដេអូនេះគឺមិនអាចទទួលយកបានទេការចំទាស់នេះមិនមានទម្ងន់នោះទេព្រោះថាអង្គហេតុដែលវីដេអូនេះភ្ជាប់គឺជាប់ទិននឹងសំណើរបស់ការចល័យសហប្រញ្ញានៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿង001គឺមិនតាក់ទិនទៅនឹងការពិចារណាសម្រាប់ភាពអាចទទួលយកបាននេះទេភាពពាក់ព័ន្ធនៃភស្តុតាងនេះជាប់ទិននឹងវីដេអូជាពិសេសគឺការសម្ភាសជាមួយនឹងជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាអំពីទូនីតិនិងមុខងាររបស់គាត់នៅក្នុងអំឡុងពេលកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យចំពោះវីដេអូទី2ជារបាយការណ៍របស់ Phiri BBC ដែលរួមមានសម្ភាសជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាត្រូវបានចំទាស់លើមូលដ្ឋានថាវីដេអូនេះគ្រាន់តែមានផ្នែកខ្លះនៃការសម្ភាសមួយរបស់នួនជានឹងថាចម្លើយដើមជាភាសាខ្មែរមិនអាចស្ដាប់បានទេដោយសារការនេះមេធាវីការពារក្តីបានលើកឡើងថាវាពិបាកក្នុងការពិនិត្យលើភាពត្រឹមត្រូវនៃកិច្ចសម្ភារនេះលោករស្មីចក្រមបើទោះបីជាសម្លេងរបស់នួនជាមិនអាចស្ដាប់ឮបានតាមការបកប្រែក្តីក៏មិនអាចនិយាយថា BBC ដែលជាស្ថាប័នព័ត៌មានដ៏មានកេរ្តិ៍ឈ្មោះល្បីបានបកប្រែដោយមិនត្រឹមត្រូវក្នុងការសម្ភារនោះទេឬក៏ថាមិនបានពិនិត្យឡើងវិញដែលនាំឲ្យមានការភ័ន្តច្រឡំនោះឡើយហើយដូច្នេះវីដេអូនេះត្រូវតែទទួលយកបានជាគោលការណ៍ការជំទាស់របស់មេធាវីត្រូវតែបានបដិសេធចោលដោយសារជាពិសេសនៅលើមូលដ្ឋានថានួនជាមិនបានអះអាងថាការសម្ភាសន៍នេះបកប្រែមិនបានត្រឹមត្រូវឡើយវីដេអូទាំងពីរនេះគឺច្បាស់ណាស់មានការពាក់ព័ន្ធដោយសារតែការសម្ភាសន៍ជាមួយនឹងនួនជាបានផ្ដល់នូវព័ត៌មានពាក់ព័ន្ធអំពីទួលនីតិគាត់នៅក្នុងម្លងពេលកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យលោករស័យចក្រមជាទីគោរពចំពោះឯកសារបោះពុម្ពផ្សាយរបស់បកគុំនេះកម្ពុជាដែលមានកំណត់ក្នុងអបសម្ព័ន្ធ2ខ្ញុំសូមធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបដូចតទៅនេះខ្ញុំនឹងលើកពីការចំទាស់របស់អៀងសេរីទៅនឹងឯកសារបោះពុម្ពផ្សាយចំនួន9របស់បកគុំនេះកម្ពុជាឯកសារទាំងនោះគឺមាន E3/5 ឬ D243/21.1 E3/99 ឬ IS6.2 E3/12 ឬ IS6.3 E3/50 ឬ D366/7.1.61 E3/4 ក្នុងវង្កចក D123/3.1 IS11.9 និង D123/3.1 E3/10 ឬ D243/21.7 E3/25 ឬ D243/21.9 E3/11 ឬ D243/2.1.12 និង E3/23 ឬ D135.1 ឯកសារ 7 ក្នុងចំណោម ឯកសារ 9 នេះគឺជា ឯកសារ បោះពុម្ពផ្សាយ ដោយបក្សកុម្មុយនីស្តកម្ពុជា ដែលរួមមាន ឯកសារ ទង់បដិវត្តន៍ ចំនួន 5 និងសារាចរ 1 និង ឯកសារ 1 ទៀត របស់រដ្ឋាភិបាល កម្ពុជា ប្រជាធិបតេយ្យ អៀងសេរី បានបដិសេធ ជាទូទៅ លើមូលដ្ឋាន ថា ការគួរ ឲ្យជឿ បាន និងភាព ត្រឹមត្រូវ នៃ ឯកសារ ទាំង នេះ គឺមិនត្រូវ បាន ពន្យល់ នឹងថាខ្លួនមិនមានឱកាសក្នុងការតតទល់ជាមួយនឹងអ្នកនិពន្ធនៃឯកសារទាំងនោះទេប៉ុន្តែទោះបីជាយ៉ាងនេះក្តីមេធាវីការពារក្តីបានខកខានក្នុងការបង្ហាញពីភាពពាក់ព័ន្ធនៃឯកសារទាំងនេះដោយដែលបានបង្ហាញនៅក្នុងដីការដំណោះស្រាយនឹងថាបញ្ជីឯកសាររបស់ការិយាល័យសហប្រាជ្ញាមានកំហុសសហប្រាជ្ញាបានពឹងផ្អែកទៅលើស្រីថ្លែងការណ៍ពីភាពពាក់ព័ន្ធនៅក្នុងឯកសារនេះ ក្នុងការបង្ហាញនៅក្នុងឯកសារដូចមានបញ្ជាក់នៅក្នុងស្នំរឿងឯកសារទាំងនេះគឺច្បាស់ណាស់ពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងប្រវត្តិសាស្ត្ររចនាសម្ព័ន្ធនិងគោលនយោបាយរបស់បក្សកុម្មុយនីស្តកម្ពុជានិងកងទ័ពបដិវត្តន៍ប្រជាជនកម្ពុជាចំពោះភាពគួរឲ្យជឿបានឯកសារទាំងនេះគឺចាប់អារម្មណ៍ទៅលើសេដ្ឋកិច្ចយុទ្ធសាស្ត្រនិងគោលនយោបាយយោធា ក៏ដូចជាសកម្មភាពនានាដទៃទៀតឯកសារទាំងនេះមាននូវការប្រើប្រាស់ពាក្យដែលតែងតែពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងបក្សកុម្មុយនីស្តកម្ពុជានិងប្រកាន់នូវមនោគមវិជ្ជារបស់ខ្លួនជាឧទាហរណ៍អត្ថបទបានប្រើពាក្យដូចជាកងទ័ពបដិវត្តន៍ពួកចក្រពត្តិអាមេរិកនិងការប្រើពាក្យកំទេចជាដើមគោលបំណងរបស់អត្ថបទបោះពុម្ពទាំងនេះ គឺច្បាស់ណាស់ដើម្បីបញ្ចូលនៅមនោគមវិជ្ជាដល់សមាជិកបកអំពីគុណនយោបាយនិងទិសដៅរបស់បកកុម្មុយនីស្តកម្ពុជាទង់បដិវត្តន៍ត្រូវបានបោះពុម្ពនិងចែកចាយជាផ្លូវការដោយក្រសួងឃោសនាការទៅឲ្យក្រសួងនានាសាកសីនានារួមមានដូចជានួនជាបានបញ្ជាក់ថាទង់បដិវត្តន៍គឺជាឯកសារបោះពុម្ពរបស់បកកុម្មុយនីស្តកម្ពុជា នឹងថាសមាជិកគណៈអចិន្ត្រៃយ៍រួមទាំងនួនជានិងពលពតផងដែរបានសរសេរអត្ថបទសម្រាប់បោះពុំនៅក្នុងទង់បដិវត្តន៍នេះលោកសរសេរចក្រមជាទីគោរពអត្ថបទបោះពុំផ្សាយរបស់ទង់បដិវត្តន៍មាននៅសញ្ញានិងទម្រង់ដូចគ្នាទំព័រគម្របខាងមុខមានរូបទង់ពីរឬច្រើនរូបញញួរ នឹងកណ្ដៀវជាសញ្ញាគមនីសគឺបង្ហាញនៅខាងមុខជំពូកនីមួយៗនិងនៅខាងក្រោយទំព័រគម្របក្រោយស្រដៀងគ្នានេះដែរមួយក្នុងចំណោមឯកសារទង់បដិវត្តន៍ដែលបានបោះពុម្ពនោះមានរូបញញួរនិងរូបកណ្ដៀវពេញទាំងអស់មានឯកសារបោះពុម្ពផ្សាយមួយចំនួននៃទង់បដិវត្តន៍ដែលរួមបញ្ចូលនៅក្នុងបញ្ជីឯកសារត្រូវបានទទួល ដាក់ក្នុងភស្តុតាងនៅក្នុងស្នំរឿងសូន01រួចហើយគ្រប់អត្ថបទបោះពុម្ពផ្សាយទាំងអស់របស់ទង់បដិវត្តន៍គឺមានលក្ខណៈដូចគ្នា ភាពគួរឲ្យជឿជាក់បាននៃឯកសារត្រូវបានចង្អុលបង្ហាញឬផ្ដល់ភាពត្រឹមត្រូវដោយសាក្សីនិងទទួលដាក់ជាភស្តុតាងរួចទៅហើយនៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងសូនសូនមួយគឺមានភាពរួមគ្នានិងអត្ថបទបទពំផ្សាយផ្សេងទៀតនៅក្នុងបញ្ជីឯកសារសេចក្តីណែនាំរបស់បកគុំនេះកម្ពុជាបើយោងឯកសារ ទៅលើបញ្ហាមួយចំនួនចុះថ្ងៃទី30ខែមីនាឆ្នាំ1976គឺតេតិនតិននឹងការបង្ហាញពីការបង្កើតនៃរដ្ឋសម្ព័ន្ធអង្គការរបស់បកគុំនេះកម្ពុជារួមទាំងអំណាចផ្លូវច្បាប់របស់ជនជាប់ចោតឈ្មោះនួនជាផងដែរដែលពេលនោះជាប្រធានសភាប្រជាជនកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យឃីវសំផនជាប្រធានប្រមុខរដ្ឋកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យ និងអៀងសេរីជាឧបនាយករដ្ឋមន្ត្រីទូតបន្ទុករក្រសួងការបរទេសសេចក្តីណែនាំក៏បានបង្ហាញពីការដឹងឮរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនិងការចូលរួមនៅក្នុងការធ្វើគុណនយោបាយបកគុំនេះកម្ពុជារួមទាំងការសម្លាប់ដោយខុសច្បាប់ទៀតផងលោកលោកស្រីចក្រមជាទីគោរពឈ្មោះរបស់សេចក្តីណែនាំបញ្ជាក់ថាឯកសារនេះគឺបានមកពីគណៈមជ្ឈិមដូចគ្នាទៅនឹងឯកសារផ្សេងទៀតរបស់បកគុំនេះកម្ពុជា ដូចជាកំតិចចក្រពតអាមេរិកនិងអត្ថន័យនៅក្នុងឯកសារគឺមានសក្កុតភាពនិងគោលនយោបាយរបស់បកគុំនេះកម្ពុជាដែលបានដឹងឮបានន័យថាការប្រើពាក្យពេចន៍និងអត្ថន័យដែលមាននៅក្នុងឯកសារទាំងអស់នោះគឺត្រូវបានចងល់បង្ហាញថាមានភាពត្រឹមត្រូវហើយដែលបានបញ្ជាក់ដោយប្រធានរបស់ DC Cam គឺលោកឈុកឆាងយុឆាងត្រូវបានទទួលយកជាភស្តុតាងនៅក្នុងសម្មនាការ ក្នុងសំរឿងដូចរួចហើយលោកសរសៃចក្រមខ្ញុំសូមអនុញ្ញាតធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងកំណត់ហេតុនៃការប្រជុំដែលមាននៅក្នុងឧបសម្ព័ន្ធទី3កំណត់ហេតុនៃការប្រជុំនេះក៏បានបញ្ជាក់យ៉ាងច្បាស់នៅក្នុងឯកសារដែលសារព្រឹត្តិញ្ញាបានដាក់ជូនរួចហើយខ្ញុំនឹងលើកឡើងពីការជំទាស់របស់អៀងសេរីទៅនឹងកំណត់ហេតុប្រជុំកងទ័ពបដិវត្តន៍ប្រជាជនកម្ពុជាដែលមានឯកសារយោង
EB/3/9ឬ IS/13/36ឯកសារនេះត្រូវបានធ្វើឡើងដោយកងទ័ពបដិវត្តន៍ប្រជាជនកម្ពុជានៅថ្ងៃទី9ខែតុលាឆ្នាំ1976ហើយមានឈ្មោះថាកិច្ចប្រជុំលេខាអនុលេខាកងពលនិងវរៈសេនាធំឯករាជ្យអៀងសេរីបានជំទាស់ទៅនឹងការទទួលយកឯកសារនេះវាលែងតែភាពត្រឹមត្រូវភាពគួរជាបាន នឹងការពាក់ព័ន្ធនានាត្រូវបានចងល់បង្ហាញឲ្យបានគ្រប់គ្រាន់និងអ្នកនិពន្ធត្រូវបានយកមកដេញដោលមេធាវីលើកឡើងថាប្រសិនបើទទួលយកជាភស្តុតាងនេះមាននៅទម្ងន់ក្នុងកម្រិតមួយតើតែមានទេការឯកសារត្រូវបានយកមកពិនិត្យឬគ្រប់គ្រងដោយការធ្វើការចងល់បង្ហាញនេះបើតាមការពិតជាជំហររបស់កាយឡាយសាវរញ្ញាដែលថា អ្នកនិពន្ធឯកសារមិនចាំបាច់កោះហៅទេប្រសិនបើភាពត្រឹមត្រូវអាចត្រូវបានធ្វើឡើងតាមរបៀបណាផ្សេងនោះមួយនោះគឺការកោះហៅនិពន្ធគឺជាការមិនចាំបាច់នេះនឹងជួយធ្វើឲ្យដំណើរការរឿងក្តីរបស់យើងដំណើរការបានយ៉ាងលឿនការខកខានរបស់មេធាវីការពីក្តីអៀវសេរីនៅក្នុងការពន្យល់ថាហេតុអ្វីបានជាភាពពាក់ព័ន្ធដែលចងល់បង្ហាញនៅក្នុងបទចោតនៃនៃការដំណោះស្រាយ នឹងការចងល់បង្ហាញដោយកាយឡៃសាប្រាញ្ញានៅក្នុងបញ្ជីលើកទី1មិនមានសភាពភាពនោះទស្សនភាពនៃការចំទាស់នេះគួរតែត្រូវបានបដិសេធចោលវាមិនមែនជាការប្រាស់ប្រាស់ពេលវេលាតុលាការនោះទេក្នុងការលើកឡើងដដែលពីភាពពាក់ព័ន្ធឯកសារដែលត្រូវបានផ្ដល់លម្អិតរួចហើយនៅក្នុងបញ្ជីឯកសារដែលបានដាក់ដោយភាគីនានានៅក្នុងខែមេសានិងម្ដងទៀតនៅក្នុងខែកក្កដា នេះឆ្នាំមុនកន្លងមកនេះឆ្នាំមុនមុននេះឆ្នាំមុនមុនចំពោះភាពគួរជាចាក់បានមានលក្ខណៈជាច្រើនដែលហាក់បង្ហាញថាឯកសារគឺត្រឹមត្រូវដូចជាប្រភពមានឈ្មោះអ្នកនិពន្ធគឺកងទ័ពបដិវត្តន៍ប្រជាជនកម្ពុជាទម្រង់ប្លង់ទំព័រនិងវាយជាអង្គលីលេខដូចគ្នាទៅនឹងកំណត់ហេតុប្រជុំយោធាផ្សេងៗទៀត រួមទាំងឯកសារដែលត្រូវបានផ្ដល់អត្តសញ្ញាណដោយកង្កយាវហៅដូច nâng át thần ấy cứ miên phiếp xí sống vạ khăn ấy chỉ mùi nâng sẽ cảm một phiếp bỏ bạc cùng đi cảm một chía không cả chắc luôn cả xua chồng lao ấy rư cả đọ chân cấp bắt niên nế nâng cả pra biệt tu tư rồi bỏ bạc cùng đi cảm một chía đôi chí cả cầm tích chế đàm lớp bình tiết ai cả xa thoa chồng lòng tại bàn phát đó đòi cài lại sạp về nhà đòi đi xì khém nóng ẩm lòng bê này cả sức bằng kết bà thăm cả lò mộ đôi chân này dưới sản phẩm thả phiếp trăm tới là bỏ ai cả xa cứ cực quan hỏi chia bị xe nóng bê là ạ vật tầm miên cả bằng hai nà môi sen tiết tôi bình ní nóng cả bằng bình tay môi cỏ lệch nếch này phiếp cú ở chư chạm bán này ai cả xa tầm ní hai đôi chân này nạn nịp bốn cứ mình chạm bách có hai mực xa xua nụ tì sẽ lấy thay ca là bỏ rõ thay bà là Campuchia bỏ chia tầm bật tay nâng rõ thay bà bỏ rụ rùm chiết nâng ở rõ nạ xe bỏ rụ rùm chiết Campuchia át thật bắt bóp xài khi nhóm số bằng hàn chun tư nâng ca rồi bỏ khi nhóm tư nâng ca cho tốp ở ngoài đài mê thì vì ca bị cái đấy bàn lực lại yên sĩ bà nhập tốt chỉ tu tư thà đầm lại là ba mà chạy thà ai cả xa tự bạc bắt băng đòi xa tại phía lùm yên cả tệ cho bạc đồ bìa nâng thà ai cả xa ní mình cua chưa chạy nâng mình xong giọng mơ bằng hành ăn hết để tự bạc bằng hành nâng chun chọc cháu mình miễn ọc các to tùl nâng nạn đi phốn át cho bắt chạc ọc nụ tề chứ thông mà đoàn tiệt yên dữ rí mình mang bắt đo mùa than ăn hết lưu ca chẩm toa nị tề đòi xa thay phó นี่ยืสนาถาการจำตัวระเบียงสีตั้งแต่ปฏิสัจเจ้าโดยสาขาเมืองทานได้กู้จีบานจำพวกเพียบแปะป้อนในไอกระซาแต่นี้โครงการช่วยบางห้าอย่างปีอำนาจประชาบหนึ่งตามอังไฮระบอจุนจบเจ้าเนินมุ่นระบอกัมพูชีประชาธิปไตยยำสมเลือกเจียวเตียวหอคือเกตดะคือสมพรเจียนยุรามเทรสไดตีหนึ่งเมียงการลำอัดตือตุสนาเกตเซมเซระบอจุนจบเจ้าตึกกันประเทศนี้ได้จีบในตุสนาเกตพลอยกาไอกระซาตันนี้บางชีบังหายไปเพียบชีสมาชิกกับเพียบในโครงการโจร่วมในขนมบัตรอุกัดสะอุกัดตะการรวมจอมพวกเพียบกู้ชีจับบานโซจินีก็ในเพียบตรำเตือนในไอกระซาตันนู้รวมเมียนมวยประคบไอกระซาไอกระซาตะบานดาธาชีไอกระซาพลอยกาหรือบ่ระนาเซบังรุบรวมชีกัมพูชีรถทาบิบาบรุบรุ่นจิตกัมพูชีเมื่อตีปีทั้งไงคายฉน้ำพฤติการในเกบาลกัตราคือมีบัญชีอย่างฉบับจิมตีใบคือมีบัญชีสัญญาพลายกาในเอกสารนู้เมื่อตีบุญบ้านบัญชีอัมพีกุมนอนระบายเอกสารคือดำใบบัญชีมโนกุมบัญชีดาวประจิจุนอัมพีกุลโยบายนังตึ๊ดได้ระบายระนาเซบรุบรุ่นจิตกัมพูชีรถทาบิบาบรุบจิตกัมพูชีนังดำใบริกุลเวียดนามแต่อาจเมื่อเคยอย่างบ้าท้าหนึ่งอาจมีในอย่างบ้าท้ามีเพียบซีสังวะคณีจิมวยหนึ่งก้นอยู่บ่ายหนึ่งตื้อได้ระบาดในญี่ปุ่นที่ปรามไอ้กระซาตระบาดเราเอาตามระยะดิสิเคมได้ชี้องการมีกุดได้ประมูลหนึ่งวิพีพอตังอัมพีระบบกัมพูชีพิจิตรปไตยเชื่อเท่าหอมวยเทียดคือมันจะมีเพียบตรำเตยระบาดไอ้กระซาอีใบสลักมรดกบุญได้จีอาตบอทบอฟไซร์บอฟระนาเซบูรุโรจิตกัมพูชีได้บ้านดัชมุท่าจีวิซาบารังคือนูเวลส์โดยกัมโบสมินเนธาไอกสารนี้คือจีชมุได้วันที่เชื่อภาษาบารังในเดือนนี้บรรจับไปเพียบทั้งเตยเตยบ้านเกิดขึ้นในตุ่มปัวจำลองจึงตุ่มปัวนี้กำลังตัดสัญญาณท่าจีกาบอฟไซด์โดยอาซังกัมพูชีดังฟอร์มชงจะเชื่อภาษาบารังคืออาซังส์กัมพูชีดังพม่าส่งหนึ่งเมียงการเลือกล้างเจริญมวยอัมพีคลำสาวิมรูมีนนกกาบบสมสายได้เมียนดัจจิเล่บบพมสายผ่องได้กีไอ้เมื่อคืนผ่องได้นกตุ่มรุ่นไอกระสานนี่หายบ้ามาเจริญนกชมัวหนึ่งเล่เรียงเมียติกานกตุ่มปอมกคือวิ่งซีสังวะชิมวยหนึ่งเล่บบพมสายดอกเตี้ยในนูเวสโดยกัมโบสการขอคานระบอบอิงสีโครงการเลือกล้างถ่าให้แต่ไว้ไอกระซามันมีนเปียปอนดูจุดอ่อนบางหายโดยเละยุ่งตื่นเลือกการจับประกันระบอบในการดำเนินสายหนึ่งด้วยได้บ้านกำลังบางหายอย่างเจ๊ะเละ នៅក្នុងបញ្ជីលើកដំបូងរបស់កាឡៃសាប្រញ្ញាការលើកឡើងនេះយើងសូមស្នើថាសូមអង្គជំនះគប្បីជំទាស់នឹងត្រូវបដិសេធចោលទាំងស្រុងលោករដ្ឋសភាក្រមជាទីគោរពខ្ញុំសូមបង្ហាញជូនមួយទៀតតទៅនឹងចំណុចរបាយការណ៍សារព័ត៌មានតទៅនឹងរបបកម្ពុជាធិបតេយ្យអៀងស្រីជំទាស់ទៅនឹងការទូទាត់ឯកសារនេះដោយឈលមូលដ្ឋានថាតម្លៃដែលអាចបញ្ជាក់បាននៃឯកសារគឺត្រូវបានលុបចោលលុបពីលើដោយសារតែភាពលំអៀងគតិច្បាប់របស់វាមេធាវីកាភិក្ដីបានថ្លែងថាឯកសារទាំងនេះមិនគួរជាចាក់បាននឹងថាអ្នកនិពន្ធមិនត្រូវបានគេស្ដាប់មិនត្រូវបានគេស្គាល់ឡើយជាថ្មីម្ដងទៀតក្រុមការពារក្តីអៀងសេរីខកខានក្នុងការបង្ហាញថាហេតុអ្វីបានជាមានភាពពាក់ព័ន្ធបង្ហាញនៅក្នុងដីការដំណោះស្រាយនិងថាហេតុអ្វីបានជាបញ្ជីឯកសារលើកទី1របស់សាភិញ្ញាមិនមានសុពលភាពនោះដោយសារការខកខាននេះសាភិញ្ញាពឹងផ្អែកទៅលើភាពពាក់ព័ន្ធនៃឯកសារទាំងនេះដោយបានចង្អុលបង្ហាញនៅក្នុងដីការដំណោះស្រាយនឹងបញ្ជីឯកសារលើកទី1របស់ខ្លួននៅក្នុងការជៀសវាងការនិយាយច្រំដាលដដែលជាដដែលដោយបានភាសាកន្លងមកដូចមកហើយចំពោះភាពឲ្យគឺជឿចាក់បានគឺវាមិនចាំបាច់ក៏ហៅអ្នកនិពន្ធទេប្រសិនបើភាពត្រឹមត្រូវរបស់ឯកសារអាចត្រូវបានបំពេញតាមរបៀបណាផ្សេងនោះរួចទៅហើយជាទូទៅរបាយការណ៍សារព័ត៌មានតាក់ទិននឹងកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យគឺជារបាយការណ៍ដែលធ្វើឡើងក្នុងអំឡុងពេលនោះយ៉ាងជាក់ច្បាស់ដែលបានបង្ហាញអំពីបញ្ហានិងដំណោះស្រាយទាំងឡាយដែលតាក់ទិនទៅនឹងបញ្ហាដែលបានកើតមកក្នុងអតីតកាលហើយវាតាក់ទិនទៅនឹងសមការនេះពេលនេះឯកសារទាំងនេះជួយក្នុងការបង្ហាញពីរចនាសម្ព័ន្ធរដ្ឋបាលពីបកគំនិតកម្ពុជានិងតាក់ទិនទៅនឹងបំលាស់ទីប្រជាជននៅដំណាក់កាលទី1ផងដែរឯកសារទាំងនេះមានប្រភពច្បាស់លាស់ផ្លូវការពីប្រព័ន្ធផ្សព្វផ្សាយរបស់បកគុំនេះកម្ពុជានិងមានភាពស៊ីសង្វាក់តាមបែបមួយដូចគ្នាទៅនឹងការប្រើវោហារស័ព្ទសំទៅនឹងលក្ខណៈរបស់ឯកសារឧទាហរណ៍ការប្រើប្រាស់ពាក្យពេចន៍ចក្រពត្តិអាមេរិកការប្រើប្រាស់ពាក្យពេចន៍បនក្បត់លន់នល់ជាញឹកញាប់ដែលឃើញមាននៅក្នុងឯកសារនោះព័ត៌មាននៅក្នុងឯកសារត្រូវបានបញ្ជាក់បន្ថែមដោយសារឯកសារផ្សេងៗទៀតដែលមាននៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងនឹងមានភាពស៊ីសង្វាក់គ្នាជាច្បាស់ជាមួយនឹងគោលនយោបាយនិងការអនុវត្តរបស់បកគុំនេះកម្ពុជាដែលគេបានដឹងឮក្នុងអំឡុងពេលនោះដោយឡែកឯកសារ E3/119 ដែលស្គាល់ផងដែរថាជាឯកសារ D262.9 បានពិភាក្សាពីអង្គហេតុនៃដំណាក់កាលទី1នៃការជំនះប្រជាជនហេតុផលនៅពីក្រោយគោលនយោបាយនៃការជំនះនេះនិងអំពីការតែងតាំងតួនាទីបុគ្គលមួយចំនួននៅក្នុងជួរបកឯកសារនេះក៏បានបង្ហាញពីបញ្ហាដែលតាក់ទិនទៅនឹងដំណាក់កាលបច្ចុប្បន្ននៃដំណើរការក្តីនិងផ្ដល់នូវព័ត៌មានសំខាន់ៗអំពីរចនាសម្បត្តិអំពីបរិបទដែលកើតមានកន្លងមកអំពីបរិបទដែលបានកើតមានកន្លងមកជាការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងការលើកឡើងរបស់មេធាវីកាពីដែលថាភស្តុតាងមិនអាចទទួលយកបានដោយសារអ្នកនិពន្ធមិនត្រូវបានលើកឡើងនៅក្នុងករណីនេះទេគឺថាព្រះញ្ញាយល់ថាការលើកឡើងរបស់មេធាវីកាពីក្តីគឺជាការមិនត្រឹមត្រូវគឺជាការមិនត្រឹមត្រូវគប្បីអង្គជំនះបដិសាចោចំពោះការលើកឡើងរបស់មេធាវីកាពីក្តីនេះបាទម្យ៉ាងវិញទៀតជាការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងការលើកឡើងនេះសាភិញ្ញាយកឃើញថាទោះបីជាការបង្ហាញពីផុសតាមប្រព័ន្ធឯកសារនិងចំណងតាក់ទិននៃអ្នកកាន់កាប់ឯកសារពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងការពិចារណាថាតើឯកសារមួយមានសុចនិករនៃភាពគួរជឿជាក់បានគ្រប់គ្រាន់ឬនៅនោះវាមិនមែនជាការតម្រូវជាមុននៃការទទួលយកផុសតាងនោះទេដូចតែបានលើកឡើងដល់អង្គជំនួយស្លាវដំបងនៅតុលាការយូហ្គោស្លាវីនៅក្នុងករណីរឿងក្តីរដ្ឋអាជ្ញាទល់នឹងអរិចនៅក្នុងសាលដីការបស់ខ្លួនចុះថ្ងៃទី30ខែមិថុនាឆ្នាំ2006នៅកថាខណ្ឌទី27ដល់28អង្គជំនួយជំនះស្លាវដំបងមិនពិចារណាពីការបង្ហាញផុសតាងនៃចំណងអ្នកកាន់កាប់ឯកសារគឺជា Senate Foreign ឬលក្ខណ្ឌសំខាន់សម្រាប់ភាពទទួលយកបាននៃភស្តុតាងនោះឡើយដូចនេះមានន័យថាគម្លាតនៅក្នុងចំណងនៃអ្នកកាន់កាប់ឯកសារគឺមិនសំខាន់ដោយសារភស្តុតាងតាមមូលបានចង្អុលបង្ហាញហួសពីវិមតិសង្ស័យទៅទៀតថាផ្នែកនៃភស្តុតាងដែលមានបញ្ហាគឺជាអ្វីដែលបានអះអាងរួចទៅហើយ លោករដ្ឋសេចក្តីក្រមដូចដែលបានលើកឡើងភាសាគ្នារួចមកហើយការអនុវត្តនៅអបតកក៏ធ្លាប់បានទទួលយករបាយការណ៍សាសព័ត៌មានដែលបានបំពេញតាមលក្ខខណ្ឌអបបរមានៃភាពពាក់ព័ន្ធនិងភាពគួរឲ្យជឿជាក់បានពលគឺមាននៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿង001អង្គជំនះបានទទួលយកនៅរបាយការណ៍សាសព័ត៌មានកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យចំនួន85រួចទៅហើយនិងរបាយការណ៍សាសព័ត៌មានអន្តរជាតិចំនួន135បានដាក់ទុកជាភស្តុតាងរួចទៅហើយការអនុវត្តនេះគឺត្រូវតាមតុលាការស្តង់ដារតុលាការអន្តរជាតិផ្សេងទៀតដែលរបាយការណ៍ព័ត៌មានគឺជាញឹកញាប់ត្រូវបានទទួលយកនិងជាទូទៅបានដាក់បញ្ចូលជាភស្តុតាងចាត់ទុកថាជាឯកសារដែលមានតម្លៃនិងជាជាងជាសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍របស់សាក្សីជាជាងជាសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍របស់សាក្សីជាពិសេសប្រសិនជារបាយការណ៍នោះបានធូរឡើងក្នុងអំឡុងពេលនោះពិតប្រាកដមែនឯកសារទាំងអស់នោះនៅក្នុងក្រុមនោះគឺបានបំពេញតាមលក្ខខណ្ឌតម្រូវតាមកម្រិតអបបរមានៃភាពគួរឲ្យជឿជាក់បានដូចនេះមិនមានន័យថាមិនមានមូលដ្ឋានណាដែលថាប្រភេទឯកសារទាំងអស់នេះគួរត្រូវបានបដិសេធមិនបញ្ចូលទៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងនោះឡើយនៅក្នុងពេលដែលអវត្តមានការសង្ស័យណាមួយទៅលើភាពត្រឹមត្រូវនៃឯកសារនោះបានន័យថាឯកសារនោះត្រូវបានគេចាត់ទុកជាឯកសារត្រឹមត្រូវនិងគួរឲ្យជឿជាក់បានដូច្នេះចាត់ទុកថាជាភស្តុតាងដែលមានតម្លៃនៅក្នុងការពិនិត្យនិងចម្រិតរឿងក្តីនេះទូលសេចក្រមជាទីគោរពអ្វីដែលខ្ញុំបានលើកឡើងនេះគឺជាការឆ្លើយតបរបស់ថាព្រញ្ញាចំពោះអ្វីដែលលោកមេធាវីការពារក្តីបានលើកឡើងតទៅទៅនឹងបញ្ហាដូចខ្ញុំបានជម្រាបកន្លងមកជាកិច្ចបន្តនេះខ្ញុំសូមអនុញ្ញាតបើសិនបើថាករីខ្ញុំមានអ្វីចង់បង្ហាញទៀតសូមលោកប្រធានមេតាអនុញ្ញាតខ្ញុំមកចប់ការអធិប្បាយរបស់ខ្ញុំតែប៉ុណ្ណេះបាទសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានសូមអរគុណលោកសេចក្តីក្រមសូមអរគុណបាទ
បាទអរគុណសាព្រញ្ញាហើយជាកិច្ចបន្តនេះផងជំរះដល់ឱកាសទៅមេធាវីនាំមុខតំណាងដើមម្ដងរបនីសម្រាប់ការធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបនេះហើយសមីទ្វីនៅមុខមានពេលវេលា15នាទីក្នុងការឆ្លើយតបសូមអញ្ជើញ
បាទសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានសូមគោរពលោកប្រធានលោកលោកស្រីចៅក្រមលោកលោកស្រីដែលជាប្រាជ្ញាជាមេធាវីតអស់គ្នានិងសាធារណជនដែលមានវត្តមានទីនេះមេធាវីនាំមុខនឹងប្រើចំណាយពេលវេលា15នាទីនេះសម្រាប់ឆ្លើយតបចំពោះការលើកឡើងរបស់ខាងមេធាវីការពារក្តីជាបឋមគឺពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងការជំទាស់ជាពិសេសអំពីភាពទទួលបាននៃឯកសារនេះមេធាវីនាំមុខយល់ថានេះគឺជាប្រព័ន្ធតុលាការមួយដែលមានចៅក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតនៅក្នុងប្រព័ន្ធតុលាការដែលមានចៅក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតនេះគឺឯកសារទាំងអស់ដែលត្រូវបានលើកដោយសហជ្រាកអាញាក្តីលើករកឃើញដោយចៅក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតក្តីដែលចៅក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតបានយកទៅប្រើប្រាស់នៅក្នុងការតាក់តែងដោយការដំណោះស្រាយរបស់ខ្លួនគឺសត្វតែឯកសារដែលចៅក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតគាត់បានពិនិត្យអំពីភាពទទួលបាននៃឯកសារទាំងអស់នោះហើយឯកសារទាំងអស់នេះប្រសិនបើចៅក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតបានយកទៅប្រើប្រាស់នៅក្នុងដោយការដំណោះស្រាយរបស់ខ្លួនគឺត្រូវតែបានសន្មត់ថាត្រូវបានទទួលយកមកអាចយកមកប្រើប្រាស់នៅក្នុងចំពោះមុខនៅអង្គជំនុំជម្រះនេះក៏នៅក្នុងវិធានទីក្នុងក៏ទុកសិទ្ធឲ្យខាងការពារក្តីនៅក្នុងការលើកអំពីការជំទាស់ទៅលើភាពមិនអាចទទួលបាននៃឯកសារនោះនៅក្នុងក្នុងអំឡុងពេលនៃសវនកម្មនេះប្រសិនបើភាគីការពារក្តីយល់ថាឯកសារនោះមិនអាចទទួលចាត់ទុកថាអាចទទួលយកបាននេះគឺជាបន្ទុករបស់ភាគីការពារក្តីនៅក្នុងការបង្ហាញថាឯកសារនោះមិនអាចទទួលយកបានវាមិនមែនជាបន្ទុករបស់ខាងព្រះអញ្ញានៅក្នុងការត្រូវបង្ហាញថាឯកសារទាំងអស់នោះត្រូវតែអាចទទួលយកបាននោះទេ ពពន់នឹងចំណុចមួយដែលនេះជាការជាយថាភាពនៃឯកសារខ្ញុំបាទជាការពុតគ្រប់ត្រួតអំពីការលើកឡើងរបស់ខាងតំណាងសហព្រះអញ្ញាហើយគ្រាន់តែមានការបញ្ជាក់បន្ថែមថាមានភាពខុសគ្នាអំពីយថាភាពនៃឯកសារនិងឯកសារដើមលោកនួនជានិងមេធាវីរបស់លោកនាងជាបានលើកតែងតែលើកជាញឹកញយថាឲ្យរកឯកសារដើមឯនៅពេលដែលសហព្រះអញ្ញាបានលើកអំពីទង់បដិវត្តដើម្បីយកចំណុចណាមួយនៅក្នុងឯកសារទង់បដិវត្តដើម្បីសួរទៅគាត់ភាពឯកសារដើមហើយនឹងយថាភាពមិនប្រកាសថាជាមិនប្រកាសថាសុទ្ធតែតម្រូវឲ្យមានឯកសារដើមនោះទេយថាភាពនេះគឺសំដៅទៅលើឯកសារមួយគឺត្រូវបានធ្វើឡើងដោយមានភាពត្រឹមត្រូវឯកសារនោះអាចជាឯកសារដើមហើយជាអាចជាឯកសារមួយដែលត្រូវបានចម្លងនឹងថៃរសាឬក៏គ្រប់គ្រងឲ្យមានលក្ខណៈត្រឹមត្រូវតាមខ្លឹមសារនៃឯកសារដើមផងដែរដូច្នេះការតម្រូវឲ្យរកឯកសារដើមដែលឯកសារដើមនេះដែលត្រូវមានអាយុរហូតមកដល់ពេលនេះលើសពី30ឆ្នាំទៅហើយនោះវាជាការលំបាកមួយឬក៏ថាមិនអាចធ្វើទៅកើតសម្រាប់សហព្រះអញ្ញានៅក្នុងការបង្ហាញឯកសារដើមនេះដូច្នេះឯកសារដែលជាឯកសារចម្លងបានត្រឹមត្រូវតាមលក្ខណៈដើមដែលមិនមានការកែប្រែខ្លឹមសារនៃឯកសារដើមដែលយើងអាចហៅថាជាឯកសារត្រឹមត្រូវនោះគួរតែត្រូវបានទទួលយកហើយនេះគឺជាអ្វីដែលវិធានទីក្នុងកំណត់ថាជាវិធានអបបរមានៅក្នុងការទទួលយកឯកសារចំពោះបញ្ហានៅក្នុងការតម្រូវឲ្យមានការកោះហៅសាក្សីឲ្យឬដែលជាអ្នកដែលបានតាក់តែងឯកសារដែលជាសិភៅនិងជាកំណត់ហេតុផ្សេងៗការកំណត់តម្រូវឲ្យមានការកោះហៅបែបនេះវានឹងធ្វើឲ្យបន្លាយពេលឯកសារបន្លាយពេលនៅក្នុងសវនកម្មកាន់តែមានច្រើនថែមទៀតកាន់តែយូរថែមទៀតនេះមានន័យថាឯកសារជាច្រើនដែលជាសិភៅជាកំណត់ហេតុសាក្សីជាឯកសារសរសេរដោយអ្នកកសែតផ្សេងៗប្រសិនបើគ្រប់ឯកសារទាំងអស់នេះត្រូវឲ្យមានការកោះហៅសាក្សីថាតើនៅពេលណាដែលសវនកម្មរបស់យើងនឹងអាចចប់ដូច្នេះរឿងក្តីនេះនឹងមិនអាចចប់នៅក្នុងរយៈពេលមួយសមស្របបានទេហើយវិធានទីក្នុងក៏បានលើកផងដែរថាតុលាការនេះត្រូវដំណើរការនៅក្នុងរយៈពេលមួយដ៏ឆាប់រហ័សដែលអាចទទួលយកទៅបានការកំណត់ឲ្យមានការតម្រូវហៅសាក្សីមកគ្រប់ករណីបែបនេះនឹងនាំឲ្យសវនកម្មនឹងបន្តទៅដោយរោផ្លូវបញ្ចប់មិនឃើញទេខ្ញុំសូមគ្រាន់តែធ្វើការបញ្ជាក់បង្ហាញពីគោលជំហររបស់ខាងមេតាវីនៅមុខតែប៉ុណ្ណេះហើយជាតបន្តទៅទៀតនេះនឹងសូមអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យលោកប្រធានអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យលោកស្រីអេលីសាបេតស៊ីម៉ូណូហ្វ័រដើម្បីធ្វើការថ្លែងឆ្លើយតបបន្ថែមសូមអរគុណ
Oui, bonjour Monsieur le Président, bonjour Madame et Messieurs les juges et bonjour à tous. De très courtes observations. La première observation est relative à la demande de la défense de Moon Jae-ha. D'entendre Monsieur Yuk Chang, nous partageons tout à fait l'avis des co-procureurs sur le fait que la convocation des collaborateurs de Monsieur Yuk Chang qui travaille à Disicam depuis 15 ans est opportune.
suffisamment démontré la expliquer à donner les explications sur la façon dont Disicam le robot de carabah macham dans la salle ni comme en tête dans le nom comme bay tha yeung chang tveu yeung mai oy pong ruom pong ruom ka pi phesa de tha nang aach ban lai pel dol rop rop khai tiet nu ne leuk tha ដោយដល់ 5 នាទីសរុបទាំង 3 ក្រុមដូច្នេះមួយក្រុមមានពេលវេលាតែ 5 នាទីទីលើកលែងតែក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីទាំង 3 ក្រុមមានការបែងចែកផ្សេងពីនេះប៉ុណ្ណោះ ហើយសូមជម្រាបសារជាថ្មីម្ដងទៀតដោយសារមានការខកគ្នារវាងការប្រើពាក្យពេចន៍ដោយសារយើងបានខិតខំក្នុងការបញ្ជាក់ឲ្យបានច្បាស់លាស់ថានាពេលនេះមេធាវីការពារក្តីទាំង 3 ក្រុមមានពេលវេលាចំនួន 15 នាទីដើម្បីធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបបានទៅក្តីថាមេធាវីសម្រាប់ មេធាវីការពារក្តីក្រុមនីមួយៗមានពេលវេលាតែ 5 នាទីទេក្នុងការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងចម្លើយតបរបស់ភាគីម្ខាងទៀតគឺសហប្រាជ្ញានិងសហមេធាវីនាំមុខតំណាងដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋវិនីលើកលែងតែក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីមានការបែងចែកពេលវេលាគ្នាផ្សេងពីនេះឥឡូវនេះអង្គជំរះប្រគល់វេទិកាទៅមេធាវីការពារក្តីនួនជាសូមជឿញ
Thank you, Your Honour, good morning, everyone. The Nunchia defense team will take It's 5 minutes. I don't think we can be much shorter than that. And I will limit my response to one point that the OCP made this morning, and I want to address this because
ទាំង 3 ក្រុមគឺមានតែ 15 នាទីទេដូច្នេះក្រុមរបស់លោកមាន 2 វេលាតែ 5 នាទីទេក្នុងការឆ្លើយតបនេះមិនហ៎ដូច្នេះសូមបញ្ជាក់ឡើងវិញប្រសិនបើគាត់ប្រើ 2 វេលាផ្សេងនេះគឺសូមធ្វើការកែសម្រួលដើម្បីឲ្យការប្រើប្រាស់ 2 វេលាមានប្រសិទ្ធភាពសូមអញ្ជើញ
Thank you, Your Honor. I hope my 5 minutes start now, and I will hurry up speaking. Again, we think that the OCP this morning misrepresented the defense's position. We have not stated that all DC camps must be declared inadmissible because they stem from DC camp, which is, in our view, a biased organization. What we have stated yesterday is that if Mr. Yuk Cheng is not hurt, only in that case should those documents be declared inadmissible. And I will explain this. We think that there are numerous very valid questions with regards to the DC CAM documents that have not been addressed appropriately in the earlier interviews of Yuk Cheng. There are very valid questions as to the provenance of numerous documents. There are valid questions as to the transfer to DC CAM of numerous documents. There are valid questions as to earlier custodians of these documents. There are valid questions as to later additions to DK-era documents by other people than Khmer Rouge officials. As I mentioned yesterday, it seems that, for example, Tuol Sleng Museum staff has added to these documents, and DC CAM personnel may have added to these documents. Those are all valid questions. One last point with regard to those questions. Yuk Cheng has also stated that to get certain documents, he needed to work with the permission of the government, with the permission of Hun Sen personally, and this means that Mr. Hun Sen had personal control over certain documents and needs to be able to question Yuk Cheng on those issues as well. Again, it is imperative that we hear Yuk Cheng on those issues because he is so personally involved with the collection of the documents. I already explained yesterday that he personally accepted each and every document, and I would like to quote one statement that he made in document number D311/2. He's questioned, he's asked by the investigating judges, could you give your personal notes about the receipt and types of documents, and the answer of Yuk Cheng is, I have my personal notes, but other people do not understand its meaning, and it only means to me. Translation by me, it means to hear Yuk Cheng on these issues, and the other witness that has been called may be able to testify about some issues of custody, but it is clear that Yuk Cheng is the right party to ask about the much broader issues. He knows more about custody, but also he knows more about authenticity and the reliability. I think that's the last point I want to make. We are not just focusing on the custody of these documents. We are also focusing on the authenticity of these documents. I feel that so far the position seems to be of the OCP that these documents are authentic because the DCCAM has stated that they are authentic. And this can be translated to these documents are considered to be authentic because Yuk Cheng says that they are authentic. For that reason, we need to question Yuk Cheng on his training, on his approach, on his technical knowledge, and also, again, I repeat, his stated preference for a handwriting sample and perhaps forensic testing of documents. May I remind you that he himself
first has stated that he considers all these documents to be authentic because he has verified them. But then, in this article that I mentioned yesterday, he states that forensic testing and handwriting samples may be needed to truly authenticate these documents. In other words, he himself is not yet convinced of his own approach.
So,
to summarize our position, if we don't get this clarification on the approach by DCCAM on the authentication of these documents, if we do not hear Yuk Chang, then these documents cannot be considered to be authentic and reliable. There will just be this black box called DCCAM of which we do not know the approach and the defense needs to be able to test this approach. That's why we ask for Mr. Yuk Chang, and that is the defense's position as to the admissibility of evidence. And I hope I have not spoken more than 5 minutes. I get the floor to my colleagues.
ធ្វើ ជា ភស្តុតាង នៅ ក្នុង តុលាការ សូម អរគុណ លោក ធាន លោក សុយ ចៅ ក្រម បាទ
បាទ អរគុណ លោក មេធាវី ជា បន្ត អញ ប្រាប់ ផ្ដល់ វិទ្យា ទៅ មេធាវី កា ពៀ ក្តី លោក អៀង សេរី សូម អញ្ជើញ
Good morning Mr. President, good morning Your Honor, good morning to everyone in and around the courtroom. I apologize if I may be speaking a little bit faster than normally, but I have a lot of territory to cover. First, let me work backwards. The civil parties talk about the threshold that was used by the OCIJ in determining that the documents were authentic, reliable, and, of course, relevant. What threshold? I remind you that we filed a third investigative request requesting from them for their methodology and modality. No answer was ever provided. Nothing is, was ever provided by the OCIJ suggesting as to how they went about. In testing the authenticity and reliability of any of the documentary evidence, and therefore, to simply say OCIJ did it, therefore we must trust it, is, in my opinion, ludicrous. And keeping in mind the constant battle that is going on now with respect to that particular organ of this particular institution, I don't think that we can just simply say that it has that much credibility, and we should therefore accept it blindly. Let me talk about very briefly the examples that were raised by the national co-prosecutor, who in my opinion simply made an offer of proof, or put it more bluntly, testified as to why he believes these documents are authentic and reliable. He claims that the content is consistent with any given examples of various words or phrases or what have you. That's his testimony. That's an offer of proof that was made by the prosecutor themselves. But obviously, they've come to the conclusion somehow that these particular words or phrases are consistent with certain individuals or certain organizations. If that is the case, then why not bring those people or show exactly why they're consistent to some sort of evidence, to simply file a motion, a submission, where they make an offer of proof is insufficient. And then it seems to be that because they made this offer of proof in writing in their submission, they want to reverse the burden on the defense, and somehow we have to now carry that burden. We submit, Your Honors, that in the international jurisprudence, it works the other way around. And that brings me to what the international co-prosecutor indicated. And yesterday we heard about the Perlitz case.
Now, it was deja
vu for me because I spent 5 years litigating Perlitz representing Dr. Perlitz. And the procedure that was used in that case, granted it's adversarial, primarily it's a hybrid system. But in that particular system, and now I'm making an offer of proof, but I will provide the trial chamber with all of the decisions concerning the admissibility of evidence. The prosecution had to present some
witness, not necessarily with a chain of custody, but a custodian as to how the documents were generated. We then heard witness testimony. At the conclusion of the witness testimony, the prosecution would then make an offer of admission of certain documents. The defense could object. The trial chamber would then make a decision. If documents due to time limitations were not presented to witnesses, then through the bar table, we were able, as a last resort, to make an offering. And then the parties would have the right to object, and the court would make a decision. It's a totally different process. I'm not suggesting you adopt that here. But if we're going to talk about international standards, I don't think the standard is, as the prosecution claims it is, and what you're suggesting is that you only look at relevance. If it purports to be relevant on its face, then accept it, because authenticity and reliability are in and of themselves one thing that can be determined later on, and that goes to the weight. We submit that is not the case. And while I appreciate the compliment, say to me that I was somewhat academic yesterday, although I hardly think that my presentation was academic, if at all. I am not suggesting that we sort of, that your honors ruminate over, you know, whether it's authentic, and then after a while go to whether it's reliable. It is a quick process. It is a very quick process. What we are suggesting, Your Honor, what we are suggesting is that there has to be some sort of a methodology for Your Honors to look at all of the evidence and to simply say that it comes from this institution or that it has this logo, and therefore from this logo, take it from us, the prosecution, it means that it's a reliable, authentic, and a relevant document is insufficient. And finally, with respect to articles and newspapers, actually that's my second to last point. In some courts, before some chambers, and I believe it was the Boskowski chamber, I'll have to look it up. In that instance, Judge Parker, who presided over that particular case, did not rely on any newspaper articles. The trial chamber in that case determined that that was insufficient. Now, I can understand that in this particular tribunal, we may wish to look at, but I don't think that simply because it says Reuters, it comes in, or Washington Post, it comes in, everything in it can be used for the truth asserted therein. Finally, and this is my final point, Your Honors, with respect to Doit and the Doit case, I wasn't at the Doit case. He was represented by another team that had another strategy that in essence came in and he pled guilty. And there was an 8-month trial process to determine whether he was indeed guilty, which is the civil law system. But to simply say that because we did this in Doit, where we should automatically do it in this case, I would respectfully suggest that that is not the test. We are in a new case, and we have to approach this evidence from a different standpoint. And I'm here representing Mr. Ng Sirree, and I'm entitled to make my objections, and I'm entitled to request that the prosecution meet its minimum burden of tendering the documents. I wasn't at Doit, and I shouldn't be, not me, but my client, Mr. Ng Sirree, should not be penalized because the Doit lawyers decided that it wasn't in their interest, or it wasn't within their theory of the case, to challenge certain documents. I apologize for speaking too quickly. 5 minutes clearly not enough for my presentation, but I appreciate nonetheless, the opportunity to give rebuttal
questions. Thank you very much.
Some Okun Lobatin, some group Krumpaksa, Junujimre, some group Kang Savanaka. Himbat, some Twerka Jumto, Jumpur, Katlai Yerobo, Sapriya, the Tha, some other people, Knonka, Pinet, Aikasa, Knodiape, Bunchnam, Kalamani, Ku, Krup Kran, some rap, how you made to be Kapi Pinet. Kapanta Kapit, Viaman Dojnote, Knung Himlerk. ការពិលឹកមុននោះគឺមានមូលដ្ឋានហើយមូលដ្ឋានដែលខ្ញុំនិយាយនេះគឺថាយើងជាមនុស្សក្នុងសមត្ថភាពជាមនុស្សមិនមែនជាទេវតាមិនមែនជាគ្រឿងម៉ាស៊ីនហើយការបណ្ឌិតឯកសារវាមានភាពដែលអាចធ្វើទៅបានហើយម្យ៉ាងទៀតសហប្រិយញ្ញាបានលើកដោយច្រឡំថាឯកសារដែលគាត់មានរាប់ពាន់ឯកសារនោះគឺកើតឡើងក្នុងពេលតែមួយគឺតាំងពីបួនឆ្នាំមុនបានថាមានឯកសាររាប់ពាន់ឆ្នាំក្នុងពេលតែមួយតែជាក់ស្ដែងវាបណ្ឌិតឆ្នាំទេ ឯកសារវាកើតឡើងបានដាក់បញ្ចូលជាបន្តបន្តហើយមានបញ្ហាត្រូវការបកប្រែភាសាហើយមេធាវីការពារមិនមានសមត្ថភាពពិនិត្យទៅលើភាសាគ្រប់ជ្រុងជ្រោយអានោះក៏ជាបញ្ហាដែលមានការលំបាកក្នុងការពិនិត្យទៅលើឯកសារជាលម្អិតដែរទី២តកតងទៅនឹងកម្រិតនៃការឬក៏ជាមូលដ្ឋាននៃការវាស់វែងតាមដែលសហប្រិយញ្ញាបានលើកអំពីថា រឿងក្តីនេះវាជារឿងក្តីធំដូច្នេះមូលដ្ឋាននៃឬក៏ការកម្រិតក្នុងការពិនិត្យផុសតាងនេះវាអាចមានកម្រិតទាបជាងរឿងក្តីធម្មតាដែលអាចឲ្យតុលាការពិនិត្យទោះបីថារឿងក្តីនោះផុសតាងឬឯកសារទាំងអស់នោះមិនជាប់ពាក់ព័ន្ធក្នុងកម្រិតខ្ពស់ក៏ដោយបាទការលើកឡើងនេះពុំមានភាពជាមូលដ្ឋានផ្លែច្បាប់ទេពីព្រោះថាបើយើងនិយាយអំពីការទទួលយកផុសតាងវាត្រូវតែអនុវត្ត ស្មើគ្នាទាំងអស់កម្រិតនៃការទទួលយកផុសតាងទោះបីរឿងក្តីតូចក៏ដោយរឿងក្តីធំក៏ដោយម្យ៉ាងទៀតសម្រាប់រឿងក្តីធំបែបនេះគួរតែមានការពិនិត្យពិចារណាដិតដល់លម្អិតជាជាងរឿងក្តីតូចតាចទៀតផងចិត្តទៅនឹងការលើកឡើងរបស់សាភរិយាដែរថាឌីសិកម បានដើរតួនាទីដូចជាប៉ូលីសនៅក្នុងតុលាការធម្មតានៅក្នុងនីតិវិធីធម្មតាដែលថាយើងដឹងអាចទទួលស្គាល់ថាប៉ូលីសប្រហែលជាមានភាពលំអៀងអញ្ចឹងឯកសារដែលប៉ូលីសបានធ្វើមិនគួរយកមកពិចារណាឬមួយយ៉ាងម៉េចបាទជាការពិតណាស់គឺថាប៉ូលីសឬនគរបាលគាត់មានតួនាទីសមត្ថកិច្ចក្នុងបែបបទជាសាធារណៈជាផ្លូវការ ដើម្បីការពារផលប្រយោជន៍ផ្លូវការផលប្រយោជន៍សាធារណៈដោយឡែកចំពោះឌីសិកេមអង្គការឯកសារកម្ពុជាគាត់មានលក្ខណៈជាឯកជនបាទក៏ប៉ុន្តែបំរើអាចថាបំរើផលប្រយោជន៍សាធារណៈដែរដោយតែគាត់រក្សាទុកនៅឯកសារប៉ុន្តែមិនមែនធ្វើឡើងក្នុងលក្ខណៈជាផ្លូវការទេខ្ញុំការការពារធៀបរបស់សាភរិយាខ្ញុំចំណុចនេះ មិនមានអ្វីជំទាស់ថាក្រុមប្រឹក្សាជំនុំជម្រះនៅពេលនេះมันអាចកោះហៅលោកឆាងយុដើម្បីឆ្លើយបំភ្លឺបានទេទោះបីជានគរបាលនៅក្នុងយន្តការទីការនៃតុលាការធម្មតាព្រមទាំងជាតិក៏ដោយក៏នគរបាលតម្រូវឲ្យមកឆ្លើយបំភ្លឺនៅចំពោះមុខតុលាការដែរដូច្នេះលោកឆាងយុក៏ត្រូវតែមកឆ្លើយបំភ្លឺចំពោះ មុខសវនាការនេះដូចគ្នាដែរតើតោងទៅនឹងការប្រាស្រ័យពេលវេលាលោកសហប្រិយញ្ញាក៏ដូចជាតំណាងដើមដឹងរដ្ឋបវីនីបានលើកថាបើសិនជាហៅសាក់សីមកច្រើនដើម្បីបំភ្លឺបញ្ហានេះអាចធ្វើឲ្យខាតពេលវេលាច្រើនណាមិនដឹងថាពេលណានឹងសវនាការនេះនឹងត្រូវចប់ក៏ប៉ុន្តែបើយើង ផ្អែកទៅលើការស្វែងរកយុត្តិធម៌មិនមែនសំដៅទៅលើការមិនហ៊ានចំណាយនៅពេលវេលានេះទេពេលវេលាចំណាយដើម្បីយុត្តិធម៌វាជារឿងដែលយើងត្រូវធ្វើហើយបើសិនជាយើងមិនដឹងការពិតថាតើឯកសារនោះវាមានភាពជឿជាក់ប៉ុណ្ណាអាចយកជាការបានប៉ុណ្ណាហើយយើងគិតថាអូខ្វះពេលដូច្នេះចេះតែឲ្យចាក់ក្រុមប្រឹក្សាជំនុំជម្រះយកមកពិចារណាធ្វើការសម្រេច អញ្ចឹងបានន័យថាយើងសម្រេចទៅលើឯកសារដែលវាមិនត្រឹមត្រូវមិនមានមូលដ្ឋានច្បាស់លាស់បាទជាក់ស្ដែងខ្ញុំបាទសូមលើកឧទាហរណ៍ការលើកឡើងរបស់ សហព្រះអញ្ញាជាតិអំបញ្ញមិននេះថាលោកខៀវសំផនផ្លត់ធ្វើជាប្រធានប្រមុខរដ្ឋបាទដូច្នេះគ្រាន់តែយើងគ្រាន់តែអំបញ្ញមិននេះបើយើងគិតមែនតែនទៅសហព្រះអញ្ញាក៏មានការងារធ្វើរហូតដល់ទៅ4ឆ្នាំកន្លងមកហើយណាតើតើកូនក្តីខ្ញុំធ្លាប់ធ្វើជាប្រធានប្រមុខរដ្ឋដែរឬទេគឺអត់មានទេគឺគាត់ធ្វើជាប្រធានគណៈប្រធានរដ្ឋមិនមែនប្រធានប្រមុខរដ្ឋទេអាហ្នឹងខ្ញុំគាត់តែចង់លើកបញ្ជាក់ថាការភ័ន្តច្រឡំវាអាចកើតមានអញ្ចឹងចុះតម្រុំអ្នកកសែតគាត់ទៅបានព័ត៌មានពីណាមកព័ត៌មានច្បាស់ទេអ្នកកសែតខ្លះជាអ្នកកសែតបរទេសគាត់យកព័ត៌មានមកមិនច្បាស់គាត់ធ្វើសេចក្តីរាយការណ៍អញ្ចឹងវាធ្វើឲ្យមានការភ័ន្តច្រឡំចំពោះអត្ថបទរបស់គាត់ដែរឧទាហរណ៍មួយទៀតសាធារណជាតិបានលើកថាលោកខៀវសំផនធ្លាប់ធ្វើជានាយករដ្ឋមន្ត្រីស្ដីទីណាតែការពិតក្នុងសម័យកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យនោះក៏ដូចជាក្រោមក្នុងសម័យតស៊ូពីសម័យមុន75លោកខៀវសំផនមិនដែលធ្លាប់ធ្វើជានាយករដ្ឋមន្ត្រីស្ដីទីអ្វីទាំងអស់ណាក៏ប៉ុន្តែមានព័ត៌មានមានកាសែតសរសេរថាលោកខៀវសំផនធ្លាប់ធ្វើជានាយករដ្ឋមន្ត្រីស្ដីទីអានេះហើយវាជាចំណុចខ្វះខាតបើសិនជាយើងមិនបានពិនិត្យទៅលើការស៊ីជ្រៅនៃការទទួលបាននូវព័ត៌មានទាំងអស់នោះទេมันអាចបញ្ជាក់ថាតើព័ត៌មាននោះត្រឹមត្រូវក្នុងកម្រិតណានោះទេយ៉ាងទៀតយើងមានបញ្ហាជាច្រើនដែលខ្ញុំបានលើកពីម្សិលមិញនៅចំណុចជាក់លាក់ទៅលើផុសតាងមួយចំនួនឯកសារមួយចំនួនក៏ប៉ុន្តែសហព្រះអញ្ញាក៏មិនបានលើកមកបង្ហាញអំពីចំណុចខ្វះខាតទាំងអស់នោះថាតើមានមែនឬក៏មិនមែននោះនៅឡើយដែរដូច្នេះជាសរុបសេចក្តីមកគឺថាការទៀមទាដើម្បីពិនិត្យទៅលើភាពត្រឹមត្រូវនៃឯកសារទាំងឡាយដែលដាក់ជូនចំពោះក្រមប្រឹក្សាជំនុំជម្រះនាពេលនេះគឺជាការចាំបាច់បំផុតសម្រាប់បញ្ជាក់ពីភាពច្បាស់លាស់ដែលអាចទទួលយកបានសម្រាប់ឲ្យក្រមប្រឹក្សាជំនុំជម្រះធ្វើសេចក្តីសម្រេចចិត្តបានដោយត្រឹមត្រូវនឹងយុត្តិធម៌បើសិនជាមិនបានទទួលនៅការបញ្ជាក់ឲ្យបានច្បាស់ពីប្រភពឯកសារក្តីពីមធ្យោបាយនៃការថែរក្សាទុកឯកសារក្តីពីភាពដែលជឿជាក់នៃខ្លឹមសារនៅក្នុងអត្ថបទទាំងនោះក្តីក្រុមប្រឹក្សាជំនុំជម្រះអាចធ្វើសេចក្តីសម្រេចដោយពុំមានយុត្តិធម៌ឡើយបាទសូមអរគុណ
បាទអរគុណលោកមេធាវីឥឡូវនេះដល់ពេលសំលមមនឹងឈប់សម្រាកហើយផងជំរះប្រកាសសម្រាក20នាទីចាប់ពីពេលនេះទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង11សូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មភាពសូមអញ្ជើញសម្រាកចុះ